Sorry. Sorry about that. So yeah, I'm going to be talking about community-oriented primary care. And then, so as you all know, I think from yesterday and even today, we have heard about the experience of our healthcare system. It is overloaded. If you go to most of our clinics, in particularly the public clinics, you'll find out that they are overcrowded. You'll find out that we are having quite a large number of people who are in our clinics, and that results into poor health outcomes because of even our healthcare workers become exhausted, and that puts so much strain into them. So we are having quite a large number of people who are sick who need to be accessing our healthcare services. Now, we have heard the story about the quadruple burden of diseases in South Africa, and this is quite a very big issue, and this is quite a very huge issue within our country. As we heard yesterday, even today, we are having quite a very big issue around HIV and AIDS. If you were to go back to about 1990, you would find out that we had way less than 500,000 patients who are living with HIV. Today, we are having closer to 8 million people, patients who are living with HIV. If you were to go back to about 1990, you would see that we had quite a very low number of patients who are having TB. Today, we are having about 400,000 patients almost every year who are diagnosed with TB, and they need access to our healthcare services. High maternal and child mortality is also quite huge, with HIV contributing also to that. The NCDs have been neglected over the past 20 years, with our focus being mostly directed towards HIV and AIDS and TB. And now maybe it is about time that we refocus our attention to the NCDs, because we know from some studies that almost every day we are losing about 700 people because of NCDs. And most of these NCDs, we can be able to prevent them by changing our lifestyle and all that. But our focus is not in that. And you also look at issues like violence and injuries. In our country, as you know, that we're ranked as one of the highest country with the number of people who are consuming alcohol. And then that puts us in a very bad situation, because unlike other countries, in South Africa, unfortunately, when people are drunk, they get to be engaged in risky behaviors, where some of them could be engaged in unprotected sexual intercourse, where some of them could drive recklessly. And those people who are involved in those injuries then would have to go to our healthcare facilities. As you know, with the issue of COVID-19 now, that alcohol puts so much strain into our healthcare services, and it contributes into those people who are involved in violence and injuries. With all this now, as we used to call it, quadruple burden of diseases, we are now having an additional one, the COVID-19, having diagnosed more than 300,000 patients within South Africa with COVID-19. That is also putting so much strain now into our already overstretched healthcare services. So our healthcare system is facing quite a huge challenge.
Network issues.
Can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, so I can go ahead. Yeah. So as I'm just summarizing this issue now, we're having a big problem. So now we have to come up with solutions. And I think most of us were quite very good in raising problems, but maybe we struggle in coming up with solutions. So maybe let me just try and go through the journey of coming up with some solutions. And maybe let me just make an example with a soccer match. And I know most of us could be familiar with how soccer is being played in different levels. If I were to make an example with the league, which is called La Liga, we know one of the best teams there is called Barcelona. And maybe I can even make an example with South Africa. The best team in South Africa is Sundowns. If you were to look at Sundowns over the past 20 years or over the past 10 years, what have happened is that before 2014, we were playing quite a very defensive kind of a soccer match. And then until one coach came to us and said, we have to change the way we're playing soccer. We have to be more attacking. We have to make sure that we focus majority of our strategies towards attacking and not sitting back and defending. So now, since we started doing that, we have seen ourselves moving up the ladder and becoming African champions, winning PSL and all the other different issues. Now, I want to take us back to the South African health system and say, in our South African context, in the health system, we are playing quite a very defensive approach, where we sit back in our post and then we wait for patients to come to us when they are already sick. In our healthcare system in South Africa, unfortunately, we wait for someone to be sick before they can be engaged with the healthcare system. Unfortunately, in South Africa, for most people, they only access the healthcare system when they are already sick. Now, what does that do to the to our healthcare system? It makes us to face so much strain into such a level that the burden of diseases such as HIV and AIDS, TB, and many others are going to score goals against us, because we are the team of the healthcare workers and we are playing against the quadruple burden of diseases such as your TB, HIV, the chronic infections, and all these other different ones. So the moment we stay back in our post, the moment we stay in our tertiary hospitals, in district hospitals, and in clinics, waiting for people to come to us when they are already sick, it's almost certain that we are going to lose this game. So now, what should we do? We should change our approach and use the example of Mamelodi Sundowns, where when Coach Peter Mosimane came, he said, we can't continue sitting back. We need to start attacking. And we started attacking and we started winning different cups. So now, what we then have to do is that we have to start attacking and start scoring goals. How do we attack? We need to make sure that we change the idea that the healthcare system starts only at a facility level. We have to now say we invest most of our resources in the community level, where we are having community health workers, where we are having nurses who are supervising community health workers, being in the community to make sure that they score goals. How do they score goals? They score goals by making sure that they prevent someone from being infected with HIV, they prevent someone from being infected with TB, they educate patients about lifestyle modifications so that they might limit their risk towards having a risk of getting chronic illnesses such as diabetes and hypertension and many other different ones. So that is quite very important. So in all this, which I'm showing you here in this particular game changer, where we have to change the game for us to deal with the quadruple burden of diseases, I'm saying we have to change the game by making sure that we don't sit and wait for people to come to us when they are already sick. I'm saying the time for patients to come to us when they are already sick is over. The time for us to wait in our clinics for patients to come to us is over. It is now time for us to make sure that we go to where people are and prioritize prevention and follow other countries who have limited resources, but they have way better health outcomes. And one of the reasons for that is because they don't wait for people to be sick before they can start assisting them. If you were to look at into the Cuban model, in the Cuban model, you don't have to see a doctor when you are sick. You'll see doctors almost regularly, at least once a month or so. And that doesn't mean that you are sick, but you have to have a frequent contact with them so that they can make sure that you prioritize prevention. I'm spending so much time on this because I think it is quite very important for you to understand what do we mean with community-oriented primary care. Now, if you were to look at the NHI and evaluate the white paper, which was released in 2017, you would see that we say that a PHC is the heartbeat of NHI, and this is quite very important. And one of the things that we need to start understanding is that when we're speaking about NHI, it is not only about the financing system. So even though the name itself, National Health Insurance, would suggest the focus should be more on the financing of NHI, I think one needs also to think about the ways of restructuring the healthcare system. And in restructuring the healthcare system, or in the intervention that can be done to strengthen our healthcare system, one needs to think about a PHC as the heartbeat of the NHI. So now, this is quite very important. NHI will never become successful if we sit with the quadruple burden of diseases and sit in hospitals and clinics and wait for patients to come to us. Whatever amount of money we spend on NHI, if we don't change the way that we do things, if we don't address the rising number of people who are living with obesity and all the other risk factors, we're never going to win. And all those risk factors can only be addressed, or can mostly be addressed, in the PHC level, which is the heartbeat of the National Health Insurance. The PHC level being the first point of contact. Now, if we're saying PHC, I think it has to be quite very clear that when we're talking about a PHC in the context of NHI, we're not just talking about clinic. We are also talking about the household level, where patients will be visited by community health workers, nurses, and many other different staff members. We are going to make sure that we assist them and we promote a healthy lifestyle. So PHC starts in the communities, as I've already mentioned. So this is quite very important for us to understand that we don't have to wait for patients to be sick before we can start assisting them. Now, if you look at the PHC reengineering, you would see that in the same document of the white paper, they talk about a WOBOT or about WOBCOT, which is municipal ward-based primary healthcare teams. These are quite very important teams because they consist of community health workers together with nurses and sometimes even dietitians and other different stakeholders. Now, what is quite very important about this is that WOBOT alone is never going to change the healthcare system, but together with things like integrated school health program, district clinical specialist team, contracting of private GPs, to make sure that we strengthen the primary healthcare, we need to make sure that we focus on all these different aspects of PHC re-engineering. But for today, I'm going to be focusing mostly on WOBOT or on WOBCOT, which is the combination of community health workers working together with the team leaders. Now, we are saying we have to go to where people live, and then we have to take a holistic approach and then make sure that we work together with shared goals and shared responsibilities, and then make sure that when healthcare providers work, because we know that when healthcare providers work together to serve people, we can have way better health outcomes. Now, there are five different principles of the community-oriented primary care approach, and these five principles are quite very important for us to understand what are we trying to do in the community level. So the first one is local health and institutional analysis. So the first thing, as we work in communities, we have to understand the communities which we are working with. What kind of community is that? Who is there? And what is their role that they are playing within the community? Also understand the burden of disease within that community. Because as you all know, if you were to go in the Western Cape, you would find out that diabetes is the number one leading cause of death. But if you were to go to KZN, you would find that TB is number one leading cause of death. So the context is always important. The local context is always important. So as we go to different communities, it is always very important for us, even for these particular WOBOT teams, for them to understand what is happening within that particular that particular community. Also, the issue of comprehensive care. Comprehensive care is quite very important that we don't only focus in one of the conditions. Like, for an example, we have seen that over the past years, our focus has been mostly on focusing on HIV and AIDS, and we've neglected the NCDs. So we're saying with the community-oriented primary care approach, we must focus comprehensively on all these different conditions so that we don't become disease-specific, but we deal with all the conditions which we come across when we are going to the community level. And then the issue of equity. Equity is quite very important, as we understand it, that the resources must be distributed in accordance with the need. Meaning that for those who are needing more resources, they should have access to more resources. Practicing with science, we can't be going blindly in the communities where we are working. We need to make sure that as we go to the communities, we use also science, we use research to guide us into telling us what interventions are working, what is not working, and what approach should we be using and what shouldn't we be using, what has been done in other areas and what can we take from those other areas where we have implemented such things. So it is quite very important that in all different clinics, in all different hospitals, as we work with WOBOT, also use a scientific approach where when community workers are going out to the communities, we have access to the data to see what is it that they see on a regular basis and then be prepared to assist those particular patients. Also, one of the most important things is that in our clinics now, as we sit in our clinics or in our hospitals, usually we just sit without knowing who is going to come in those particular facilities. So we just sit without knowing how many people within the community who are sick, who are having HIV, who are having diabetes. We only know those who come to the hospital, but we don't have a clear understanding of those who do not present to the hospital. We're only going to see them the moment they come to the hospital. So it is quite very important that as we implement COPC, we also make sure that we use an approach where we use scientific evidence to guide us in our approach to motivate for whatever intervention that we are using. And then we are guided by service integration around users to make sure that we are led by our users, and our users in this instance are people, community members who are within our community, so that we know what are the needs of those community members. We move together with those different stakeholders. We identify their needs and we plan together. We don't come with our own ideas and impose them on the people. Whatever we do, we need to be led by people and communicate whatever our strategies and see if they see them as being feasible for implementation in those different communities. So that's quite very important as we implement the community-oriented primary care. So now, what is, COPC is a practice that follows a process. So what process do we follow? So as we identify the community, for an example, if we were to identify a community, a small community in Tswane, what we would then have to do with that community, would have to know if would have to form a robot team. And then once we have formed a team of robots, and in most instances, a team of robots would consist of about 12 community workers led by one nurse. It either can be a staff nurse or a professional nurse in some instances. So once then we have that particular team, we need to make sure that we link that particular team to the healthcare system. And then once we have done that, by linking it to the health system, I mean we link it to a clinic, and then we prepare and train the community health workers. But in that process, we also make sure that we work together with the community members, and then we map the community, allocate community health workers in accordance to the needs. So in areas where we need, where we think that they need more of assistance, then we focus majority of our resources in that particular area. So we don't follow a size one fits all approach where we say we must have 250 community health workers, or we don't follow an approach where we say each community health worker must have at least 250 households. We don't do that. We say each community health worker must have an area where, must have a group of households where they are going to be able to effectively assist those community members. So if you go to the rural areas, it might not be practical for you to say they need to see 250 household members because of the distance and the geographic location in those, within those areas. So it is quite very important that in our approach, we use strategies and ways which can work in those particular communities. And then we do what we call this local institutional support assessment, which I've already spoken about, where we have to see who is where, what resources are they bringing, how can they support us, and then we move forward together to make sure that we can utilize whatever services. And this is quite very important because community health workers in most instances, currently now in our country, I think our strategy of training community health workers says that they can be trained for 10 days and then they get continuous trainings over a period of time. So which is quite very important that to understand their training, because you would understand that they might not have many more skills to deal with quite a comprehensive challenges which they are, that are going to come across within the different household members. So what is then important is that as you identify all the relevant stakeholders, such as the GPs within that community, the social workers, the dietitians, and many of these other different stakeholders, when they identify them and they form a working relationship, they then are preparing for a day where they go to a particular household, they find challenges, then they can easily be able to say that we have a relationship with a particular social worker who can be able to assist you with this. So now that forms quite a very strong team, because even though they don't have enough skills to deal with those challenges, but at least they have communication or they have a way of referring patients to those different other stakeholders. So, and then they then do what we call a household and individual health assessment. Now, this is quite very important because once they do this household assessment, where they ask questions around who's staying there, the age of everyone who's staying in that particular household, the issues about chronic illnesses, the issues about the environmental status of that particular household, this helps us to be able to identify the community at which we are feeding as clinics so that we can prepare for what is coming. And then the issue of now providing services. When they provide services, they focus more on health promotion, prevention, supporting those who are on treatment. When we're saying support those on treatment, we're talking about things like, for an example, we know that we're having quite a very high default rate when it comes to TB treatment, and it's even worse now with coronavirus. So we need to make sure that community workers are always there to support patients who are living with those chronic illnesses. Because as we understand, for most of us, it becomes difficult for us to complete one a week of prescription of medication. So now then we can't just expect patients to easily complete 6 months treatment or lifelong treatment without any interruption. So we are saying community workers should always be there to support those who are on chronic medication. And then this is just an example of the ward-based outreach team maps, where a community health worker, community health workers would have divided the community and divided the household to say this one must cover that particular household. So now this is an example of a team of a work team, part of the COPC integrated district services. And then it is also important to know that all these robots, they are linked to a clinic, and then they are also based in the community where there are churches, there are schools and clinics. They are led by a health professional, which in this instance is most likely to be a nurse, and then made up of community health care workers 8 to 15, which I've already mentioned. So now, it is quite very important that the level of management and integration to healthcare services is in different levels. For an example, we're having a household, and then from the household, we're having a community, then we're having a facility catchment area. So all those different aspects, all those different levels, they are quite very important for us. So what then happens is that we are having an individual family being cared for by a community health worker, and then that community health worker belongs to a community health team or a robot team. And that robot team reports to a particular clinic, and that clinic is under a district or whatever management, which is quite very important for in the implementation of COPC. Because if we want to successfully implement a COPC, we have to make sure that in all different levels, we are having managerial supervision of almost everyone. So at national level, we have to make sure that we have someone who's responsible for making sure that in all different provinces, robot is taken seriously. In provincial level, we have to make sure that they supervise the different districts, and then the different districts make sure that all the sub-districts are performing in an expected way. So the community health worker is not a nurse, is not a subordinate or to a clinician, is not a maid, but the community health worker is a full member of the COPC or of the robot team, who is based in the community and is accountable to the Department of Health. In most instances, they would have been trained for about 10 days, and then they would receive the ongoing services. Most likely in many areas, those happens on Friday. So at least in 1 week, in a week's time, at least one day is dedicated towards training, which is quite very important, because that is mostly focusing on the conditions which they are coming across on daily basis. Now, it is also quite very important for us to see if this is cost effective compared to the approach of sitting in clinics and just waiting for a patient to come to the hospital. So as you can see here, we're having quite an overwhelming evidence which shows that for different issues, such as making sure that we provide or we support community-based towards patients who are living with HIV and towards patients who are taking TB medication. We have seen that community health workers cost 11% of the facility-based alternative while saving outpatient visits when it comes to making sure that they are offering HIV services or TB services. So in many different aspects, we have seen that community oriented primary care approach saves us quite a lot of money. And for us, we need to start thinking. In South Africa, for an example, if I were to make an example, in South Africa, we are having about almost every year, we get about 400,000 patients who are diagnosed with TB, or up to 450,000 patients who are diagnosed with TB. Each of those patients would have to be treated with around 3,500 over a period of 6 months. And then if you were to look at those particular patients, if they were to develop MDR, it would go up to about 90,000 rand treating each patient. If they were to develop SDR, they would need just about 350,000 for them to be treated for SDR. Now, I'm just talking about one patient. Now, if we were to focus most of our resources towards making sure that we prevent these patients from not having TB in the first instance, because we know TB, not only is it preventable, but it is also curable. So why then should we have such a condition being a leading cause of death in South Africa? A disease which we can prevent, a disease which we can cure, remains one of the number one leading cause of death in South Africa. Why is that? That is happening because our approach says that wait for someone to have TB before we can start helping them. So now we need to start changing our approach and saying that we need to change and focus more in prevention. Now, we cannot do that, especially when we're in the fourth industrial revolution, without focusing in technology, in the ICT. So now, what is important is that all community health workers in all different levels, they need to make sure, we need to make sure that they are having access to a different platforms. And here I'm making an example with one of the platforms which we have used in Tshwane, which is called iTaHealth, which we're able to collect data or to register about 600,000 people in Tshwane. Now, that's quite a lot. So, and you would see that, you'll appreciate that for the first time, clinics would then have access to see who in the community members, who in the community is having TB symptoms. Because previously, we never knew that until patients presented themselves into our clinics. So in the fourth industrial revolution, we need to make sure that we use technology for community health workers to move around the community, for us to be able to see where are they, what is it that they are doing, and then to make sure that we are able to assist them where there is a need. So as you know, the issue of supervision is quite very important. And I think yesterday and even today, we've heard that management of the limited resources which we are having is quite very important. So managing of community workers is also quite very important for team leaders who are supervising them. And unfortunately, one team leader can't be with all the 12 different community workers. But using technology, it makes it easier for them for the team leaders to be able to supervise and to monitor the performance of the community workers in all the different areas where they are. Because using the GPS location, they can tell which community worker is where and what is it that they are doing, so that we don't spend so much money in having community workers, head workers who are just sitting wherever they are and not doing what they are doing. So as we invest so much resources into community workers, we need to make sure that we involve the ITC platform where we can easily monitor and supervise community workers to see if they are doing what they are supposed to be doing. But also we can use the data collected to make sure that we plan whatever that needs to be done in our communities. So what can we do with different ICT platforms? We can make sure that we register the different household, make sure that we do our assessment of household and individuals. We manage the follow-up visits. As you all know, community workers might be responsible for quite a large number of different households. So when they go for household registration, they would come across with quite a large number of different needs in that particular household. So they would have to do a follow-up visit. So now when they do a follow-up visit, we need to make sure that in that particular household, they are, or the community workers have a way of diarising that in an easier way. And ITC, the iTaHealth does then assist them to be able to make sure that it reminds them on the day when they need to go back to that particular household and do the follow-up visit. Performance monitoring, like I've already said, reporting. And so we know currently now that the team leaders in many different areas where they're supervising community health workers would spend about 3 to 5 days in a month's time just working on reporting. And we're saying we shouldn't be doing that. Preparing the report for which has to be submitted. So we're saying in the fourth industrial revolution, we have to make sure that we allow technology to do data collection, to do the reporting, and to do the analysis, because it can assist us, it can easily do that. So instead of team leaders or of nurses focusing in making sure that they collect the stats and all that, we need to make sure that we use technology for it to do its part in collecting the data and preparing reports. And then we'll release nurses to focus in more complicated issues, to focus in issues where they were trained in doing the nursing stuff and less in preparing reports and all that. So now, just in a nutshell, we have community workers who in some of the ITC platforms, they can be able to register households to assess the households, and then team leaders will be able to supervise them, like I've already mentioned. So just to make an example, when a community health worker is going to a particular household, that the whatever information they are collecting it can easily be fed to a cloud, which then goes to robot management. It goes to Department of Health for analysis. It can also go to many different other aspects, people who want to do research, so that it guides us towards a practice without to practicing with science. And then maybe just as I'm closing, so robot is one of the most important parts of the NHI, like you saw in the first, in one of the first slides which I showed you. So one of the most important things here is that as we implement it, we have to make sure that it does work and it works correctly, because it doesn't help for us to just have community workers, but then it doesn't really help us in what we want to achieve. So if we look at the evaluation of the first phase of the implementation of NHI, we can see that robots, about 12 million households were registered by different community health workers across the country. Now, this is quite very important. These are the households which were never registered before. These are the households which we didn't know what conditions we're having. At least now we have access to that particular information. At least now in those particular areas, we can be able to plan and to be ready for those particular household members, whom some of them, quite a large number of them, in this particular area or in this particular instance, we discovered that they were having TB symptoms. We then took them to the healthcare facilities. They were then tested for TB, and then we identified them. So in that way, we're preventing them from spreading TB, but we're also saving their lives, because when you take TB treatment correctly, we know that it can easily be cured. Now, we know that during this particular phase, from 2011 to around 2017, about 3,323 robots were introduced within the country. And these are quite very important for us as we move forward, because we know that this particular robot would then be responsible for almost everyone, to make sure that everyone gets access to healthcare. Obviously, we know that there were some challenges which were raised, like for an example, teams often lacked an envisioned team composition, with many teams lacking team leaders. So many of the teams did not have nurses who are supporting them. So we're saying, as we move forward, as we're saying we must implement NHI, and maybe as one of the last things which I'm going to say, I think we have to agree that the status quo can't remain the same. It has to change. We can't have quite a large number of people having no access to quality healthcare. And in doing that, we have to make sure that the foundation is quite very strong. And what is the foundation? The foundation is making sure that we focus more on preventative medicine. And how do we do that? By having community health workers. So the biggest issue here is that everyone needs to have access to quality healthcare. I think all of us, we have to agree that we all deserve to have access to quality healthcare. Poor or rich, we have to make sure that everyone here in South Africa is having access to quality healthcare. How then do we achieve that access to quality healthcare? I think then that we can debate. So I'm saying all of us must be in the same page. No one should be having shouldn't be having access to quality healthcare. So at the departure point, as we're debating NHI, we need to say the first thing that we have to agree on as the country is that everyone must have access to quality healthcare. Then we can debate the issues of, or the vehicle of, offering that access to quality healthcare for all. I thank you all for the opportunity, and I can be able now to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sandile, for your presentation. Are there any comments or questions? Paramile, you have something to say? Paramile, go ahead.
I see that Paramile, we don't see a mic.
Yeah.
The mic will have to appear before she can speak. The mic sign.
Can you unmute yourself, Paramile?
Oh, there we go. Hello, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay, thank you for your patience. I was actually looking for the mic. Daniela, thank you very much for a spirited presentation. I just really have a comment, and it actually comes out of what Ms. James said in the previous presentation, which is about the activation of consumers. For me, your model for changing the game really speaks to looking at the psychosocial aspect of treating people with chronic conditions. And I think your model could possibly improve on doing that, because once people are activated and they know how to treat their conditions, they actually become people with rights and can inform how their health is given to them as a service, etc. So I think that's critical. Also taking into consideration this principle, this 80-20 principle that people are finding internationally, that 80% of healthcare utilization costs are caused by people most at risk who most likely have chronic conditions. So if the psychosocial skills of that can come out more in your model, how that is improved and how that in fact will improve healthcare spend make people, the healthcare system, more responsive to people's needs and bring all people to the center of the health delivery system and how it responds to improving people's outcomes. And I suppose the critical point that was raised in the previous presentation, what do we do about patient experience? And I think maybe that model of yours, if you could factor those in, these are just comments really, but I think they are there. You've had a lot to say. Thank you. Thanks for your presentation.
Thank you very much. Thanks. And yes, I agree with your comment. And one of the things that we have seen is that in South Africa, I think when it comes to health literacy, we are one of the poorest countries in that regard. And for an example, if you were to ask most of our patients what medication are they taking, those who are on chronic medication, most of them would just say, I'm taking that black tablet or that green or that blue or whatever color of a tablet, but they wouldn't know exactly the name, they wouldn't know the side effect, they wouldn't know quite a number of issues surrounding that particular issue. So we need to have to try and improve the health literacy, and we can do that through community health workers. So working together with the social workers and working together with the psychologists and all that, community workers in many areas have shown improved health outcomes and even the psychological outcomes. And that is quite very important that in this particular team, it doesn't also only include the nurse or the clinicians. It also includes other different aspects of healthcare, which has been neglected in the previous years. The issue of mental health is coming out quite very strongly. We have noticed that in Tswane, where we're working, there's quite a large number of patients or of household members who raise mental health issues, which were previously neglected. And if we never went to them, we wouldn't have known until they would have been in an advanced level of that particular situation. So it is quite very important that we make sure that we prioritize and we take services to the people, but also listen to them and work together with them to resolve whatever different challenges that they might be having in many different aspects. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have another hand from Okore.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. You raised very important issues that I believe are quite pertinent with regard to addressing our current health system challenges. I do have two brief questions for you. One is this: you've raised the issue of NHI not being just about financing, and you're correct. The way that the policy has been framed, it's not just about financing, it's also about changing the way that we deliver health services. And I do agree with you that we have to move away from just responding to people being sick, but also changing the way that people behave. But and community health services will be an important aspect of that. So my question is this: one will be, is it possible to change the way that a health system functions by strengthening community health services without changing and moving to an insurance model? That's one question. Now, the second one, very quickly, is we're dealing with right now with, like you talk about HIV and AIDS, it used to be 800,000 and moved to 5 million and so on and so forth. This is about behavior and culture. And in order to address these things, one of the areas definitely will be changes within the communities. But there are other areas too. We've got family structure, religious institutions, education. It's a much broader area. How do you think that one could bring all of these things to bear in order to change behavior going forward?
You are muted, Sandile.
Thank you very much. That I think that is quite a very important question, and it's very difficult one, the first one. So now, do we really need NHI for us to be able to implement community-based services? Well, most likely, maybe we don't. But for us to have enough resources and enough funds to be able to fund these community programs, I think we need quite a very strong pocket where we can take money from to be able to successfully employ community health workers across the country and make sure that they are all paid what they deserve and they are sustainable. So as you might know, in the country currently we're having about 50 something thousand community health workers who are employed. Most of them were struggling to employ them permanently, and that gives us quite a headache, and we need money to come from somewhere, but we don't have enough within the available budgets to be able to pay all those different community health workers. So the big issue now is, while it is quite very important for us to have community health workers, where are we going to get the money where is the money going to come from? So do we really need NHI for us to be able to implement the community-based services? Maybe not. But I would say we need enough money to be able to support all these different services which are offered by the community health workers. So unless then it will be important that we have enough money to be able to fund the community services, and NHI is bringing that. So unless we have an alternative which can fund this, I think then we might not need NHI in that particular regard. So while I feel strongly that NHI is needed, but I think there are some aspects where we still have to make sure that we motivate and we make sure that we give more evidence to support our ideas. And then the second issue here, the issue of stakeholder engagement, is quite very important. And that is why I spoke about the local institutional support assessment, where we need to make sure that we identify all these different stakeholders. And these different stakeholders include the church leaders, include the traditional healers, include the all the different levels, the sport people, everyone. We need to work together as a country to change the behavior. If you were to look at our country now, I think most of our troubles can easily be related to our healthcare, to our behaviors. And if we were to engage in a more stronger approach of making sure that we change our behavior in the upcoming years, I think we could drastically change the health outcomes within our country. So I agree, we have to work together with different stakeholders, because I think we all have a role to play here. It's not just about us as healthcare workers, but many other different role players. Thank you. I think you are still muted.
Okay, thank you, Sandile, for that presentation. I don't see any hand except a comment from Grant. He's saying he feels he's more understanding of the current primary healthcare strategy and practice. Thank you so much. We have to move on to our last presentation.